What is that? Oh my god. What? It's the Insulindian Phasmid? A delicate tangle of arms and legs unfolds from the reeds, limb by limb, to just stand there, moving its scythe-like arms in ghostly silence. I don't want to point to it, it'll run away, blink. It's still there, an unfolding mechanism of reed-like chitin hovering in place. What is that? I'm like, looking at it, it looked like it was coming closer. The old man looks at the reeds, then at you. What are you talking about? The giant stick insect. He looks confused. There's nothing there. The stick insect is over 3 meters tall. It looks straight at you with its tiny pinprick eyes and its grotesquely small head. Half-light says you feel your legs shaking under you and your gunned hand rise instinctively. There is! I see it! Tell me what you see, damn it. I can't make out one small thing in the reeds. So I guess if we succeeded the perception hearing check, we could have heard it as well. Kim, can you see it? I can see it. 4 simple words. Thank God. If he can see, then you're not insane, Volition says. Logic says, but that means... It's really there, spinning slowly, in absolute silence, its limbs long and slender. Be very, very careful, the lieutenant whispers, then takes a step toward the giant arthropod.
Yes?
The creature stands on long stilt-like legs, antenna hanging from its head like a woman's hair, white and curled at the tips. I keep stopping when it looks like it's advancing. It is no more than 5 steps away from you. Inspect the phasmid. Go to it carefully, it may be dangerous. Approach the insect first, get close to it. Reed-like tufts stick out of its joints. As the insect moves its forearms, it produces a faint hiss, like a reel-to-reel machine spinning after the tape breaks. This is the Insulindian Phasmid.
It is.
The lieutenant whispers something behind you. You hear the familiar ring of his jacket unzipping, slowly, painstakingly so. He's gonna take a picture of it. You glance over your shoulder. The man holds a piece of milled aluminum. He begins to pull it open extremely carefully. It's the camera. Savoir Faire says, no. The flash will scare the creature off. Warn him now. Kim, the flash is loud. It won't like that.
We need a photo. No one will believe us.
He continues to pull the lens open. From the corner of your eye, you see a sudden cascade of motion ripple through the phasmid's limbs. A series of ultrasonic clicks fills your ear. Stop. Let me approach it first.
I won't be one of those fools who didn't take a picture.
He has stopped fiddling with the camera, but does not put it down. You see the phasmid turn to him, its mandible antenna reaching out. The motions are quick, sudden. Who cares what they think, Kim?
Understood.
He comes to, abruptly, and he says that with a nod. The spindly mechanism turns itself back to you, its antenna taking their measure of the air, slowly. I don't want to say this and then lose this skill check here. I think we can get this unless we get 2 ones, which always fail. Electrochemistry. +1 for your corpse will be marked by stars and laid the pheromone on thick. Oh, that's right. I still have that on me. +3 for Lena's childhood experience. Approach carefully. Slowly, with your breath held, you take two small steps toward the phasmid. The creature lets out a series of ultrasonic clicks that swarm around your head, like swallows. Empathy says, like laughter, a sort of happiness. Endurance says, sweat drips from your brow, soaking your chest. You reek of it, your chemicals. Encyclopedia says, the tracheal system on the creature's abdomen expands in front of you to take in and expel air. It's smelling you. Hissing and clicking, it extends its mandible-like antenna to greet you. You're right below it now, looking up at the colossal chitin of its white limbs. The head of the creature is crowned by reeds, and its eyes are like small droplets of water. Look behind you. It's smelling me. Maybe it is real. The pheromone. The lieutenant's mouth is agape. Authority says, about now, he's ready to believe anything. The insect's head is crowned with reed-like scales, the shape of seed heads. They rustle as the air moves. The ventricles at its abdomen continue to expand like lunglets. Breathing you in, electrochemistry says, you're a sour, greasy semiole chemicals on the breeze. Hello, I'm Harry. I don't really know who I am. No reply. A total ancient silence comes from its mouth, along with what appears to be some kind of foam. The stridulations of its limbs continue all around you. Stand on your tiptoes and look more closely. Oh, back off. Wait a second. Stand on your tiptoes and look more closely. You are right. Little bubbles form on the mouth parts of the creature, on its segmented lower lip. It looks to be foaming slowly. The foam is white, even yellowish. Kim, it's foaming. Careful, it may be poisonous. The lieutenant watches you apprehensively. The foam slowly turns a darker shade, like burnt caramel. As the insect moves its mouth parts, masticating, the little bubbles begin to burst one by one. I'm afraid if I do this, take the picture, everything's gonna be over. Ditto for that, obviously, we're leaving. Raise my hand. Inland Empire. Very high. +1 for spoke to the hanged man and knows of parthenogenesis. And +2 for did not give up on Phasmid. Tell me, what are you doing? I exist. What exactly are you? I am an unknown species of the order Phantasmodea, endemic to the Insulindian Isola. For the last 350 years I have hidden in plain sight, masquerading as the reeds, molding, cloning myself, unfolding at night to play with trash bins and buoys. It took the documents. It took Clashay's documents. I went unnoticed by the first settlers and the land surveyors on the suzerain, also by the soldiers of the revolution, and the officials of the occupation. Even the Seminese islanders who came here first but did not stay have not seen me. Now I realize, of course, that guys, this is not talking to me. This is my brain figuring out what it is. I have stayed hidden through 4 forms of government and 2 scientific revolutions until I was accidentally discovered by a detective of the Citizens' Militia in Revachol, District of Martinez, March 51. Is that current day? Investigate the insect until it's no longer there. Is this a dream? What is happening? No, you're awake. I am real. Light is forming me. This is real. I exist too. Tell me what it's like for you. If I tell you, what will happen? Then I will tell you what it's like for me. For me, it's fire, burning. Fire? Where? Inside. I do not have fire inside me. In me, there is not even blood, but lymph, like sap from a wine palm. Now I will tell you what it's like for me. For me, it is a series of half-lit images, a kind of darkness, being intruded upon, transient, dim, moist. Intruded upon by what? Shapes of plants and animals, and internal sensations, A swarm of sounds, tiny vibrations on the inside of my forearms, all speak of complexities totally beyond my understanding. I am at the end of a narrow funnel, weightless. So light it only feels like something to be me. In truth, perhaps I'm nothing? I certainly do not have a soul, and if I did, it would never burn. You're the type of animal I would like to be. Are you sure? Yes, I'm sure. Why do you ask? Sometimes, when molting, I regrow a lost limb. One time something went wrong and a small leg replaced a missing antenna. A small leg? That's horrible. Yes, the leg tried to move around independently, making it hard to walk. You don't have a foot there now. Yes, thankfully someone ate it. The next time I molted, I grew an antenna again. I am a detective. So am I. I was born to detect sucrose rewards and semiochemicals. What were you born to detect? I was born to detect you. Yes. No one detected me for such a long, long time. For thousands of years, I dithered out of sight, draped myself in greenery. No, this is just an accident. No, no one believed I exist. Almost no one. Until you came, detective. Dripping of blood that smells like strawberries. Across the calm sea. The first in 1,000 years. Where does this come from? All this. Around us. The world? Not even the birds know that. Not even the water lilies. We need to know. Perhaps it was sent to us by a god? I think we should eat it. If it's a leaf, you can put it in your mouth. Or a reed. Yum yum. Reaction speed says, wait, So you look like a reed? And you eat reeds? Yes, they don't mind. Is this too sensitive a matter? Have you accidentally eaten another reed phasmid? Yes, I once cloned myself and ate the little ones. It was winter, and I woke up at the wrong time. It was an accident. That's insane. No, you are. The moral of our encounter is, I am a relatively median life form, while it is you who are total, extreme madness, a volatile simian nervous system, ominously new to the planet. The pale, too, came with you. No one remembers it before you. The Kandarians do not. The radially symmetrics do not. There was an almost unanimous agreement between the birds and the plants that you were going to destroy us all. The pale came with you. Wait, the pale is human-made? It is a nervous shadow cast into the world by you, eating away at reality, a great unnatural territory. Its advent coincides with the arrival of the human mind. I don't have that kind of power. You are a violent and irrepressible miracle. The vacuum of cosmos and the stars burning in it are afraid of you. Given enough time, you would wipe us all out and replace us with nothing, just by accident. How? We suspect it will be something like the oxygen holocaust that wiped out anaerobic life 2.6 billion years ago, when organisms first started breathing, only much worse. Conceptualization says, instead of air, you exhale thoughts. There are no trees that eat thoughts. So the pale is the power of thought? Worse how? Everything your eyes touch goes back there, behind the nerve mirror. What if you blink? Are we still here? Please don't blink. What if you misplace us all one day, or just forget? I'm not going to blink. Ask nicely. But I want to blink and undo 12 billion years of matter No, I do not. Have I always thought this way? No. You're only thinking it now. This is a revelation. I will be extra careful not to blink, stick insect. Don't worry. Please be. Or one day one of you will close your eyes and sigh, and open them to see that none of this ever existed. Kim, am I having a violent epileptic seizure? It doesn't look like that, no. What does it look like? You're just staring at it, he whispers. Then I think I'm having a vision about the final fate of mankind. Okay. After a second, the lieutenant asks, is it somehow related to the case? The case? The case is meaningless compared to this. I have totally transcended the case. I think we should take the picture, and then you should back away from the unstudied species. Okay, I have to say goodbye now. I have no more thoughts. That was all. No, there is one more. Of all the creatures I've met, you are the most beautiful. Thank you. I also have one more thing to say to you. That woman. Turn from the ruin. Turn and go forward. Do it for the working class. What woman? You cannot lie to me. Behind you it smells of fires. So awfully far you were prepared to go in her presence. End it. I will try. She was middle class. It doesn't take a 3-meter stick insect to tell you that. Okay, Kim, take the picture. Okay. With a slow ring of metal, the lieutenant slides the lens open and raises it to eye level. He's not gonna get that picture. There was no change in the insect's motion while it was being aimed by the camera. It remains fixated on you. In three, the man whispers. His voice is tense. If it moves, you jump back. I'll shoot. Here we go. 3, 2, 1. The shrill flash of the camera cuts the air like the blade of a sword. The phasmid freezes in its bright light, head turned toward the lieutenant. Hypnotized by the flash, it stands frozen before you. I got it, you hear the lieutenant whisper, as the creature's shape develops onto photo paper in his hand. A polychrome ghost of white streaks across against the reeds in the sky, and you as a shadow before it. Slowly reach out and touch the creature's whisker. The antenna hang from a great height. With your hand shaking, you barely touch the tip of the left whisker. On cacti, the chitin curls into a spiral, like the tip of a poison ivy. Its touch on your fingertip feels cold, ticklish. Interfacing says it is surprisingly delicate, the curly end of the whisker, like a young vine. Vine? It's even a bit wet. Be careful, detective. It's moving. Look at your finger. You're right. It glistens with some kind of moisture. The creature in front of you stays frozen. Why am I gonna lick my finger? Carefully pet its scythe-like forearm. Once he chops off my arm. The limb before you is incredibly light. Like an eggshell, it's much lighter than a reed. You feel a soft push could tip the creature over, its hollow exoskeleton collapsing. Reaction speed says warning. Pull your hand away. A sudden shiver passes the limb. Looks like the creature is awakening, wave by wave from its stupor. Visual calculus says some sort of countdown process is happening. That's all you have time to think. Okay, I'm not gonna lick my finger. We got it. Back off. Another shudder passes through the creature's limbs. It jolts back to life like a record continuing where it left off. In a swaying, praying motion, even the small black pearls of its eyes do not stray from you. Okay, I hadn't chose this yet. Raise your hand slowly. The insect stops its stridulation, seeming to observe you. Below its crown of reeds, little pinprick eyes detect motion, glittering. The world stands still around you. Perception says suddenly there is silence. Raise the other hand, too. As you do, the invertebrate comes to life, its limbs moving independent of each other, as if each has a mind of its own. They are white, like stalks of porcelain knitting above you. Conceptualization says, praying to you. That's right, pray. Unwittingly, the insect continues its stridulations as it moves tough-like structures still pretending to be plants rustle along in its joints. Disengage slowly. As you're turning away, the phasmid mirrors your movements, stepping on the water, The long limbs carry its feather weight without breaking its surface. Wow. That's awesome. Goodbye. And just like that, it's gone, skating away across the sea's calm mirror like a skipping stone, leaving nothing but circles on the water. Perception says, and something under it, in the place it stood, bobbing there among the reeds, a collection of items. It's gone. The lieutenant looks north, with his hand raised to his brow. Maybe it's Classier's documents. It can walk on water? Apparently, yes. Like a water strider, only... He shakes his head with amazement. I've never seen anything like that in my life. What's that? In the reeds. He squints. Looks like a nest of some sort. We should have a look. What now? What now? The old man behind you repeats suddenly. He's put his hand into the ash. It's dirty and black. Empathy says, in some kind of strange semi-catatonic state. A suspect not looking so good. We need to check on him. Phasmid's gone. Check up on the deserter now. But there's something in the reeds. A Fairweather T-500 helmet. And there's the scope for the rifle. Look at the helmet first. +1/2 light for head as battering ram. -1 suggestion says a fighter, not a lover. This monstrous-looking bug-eyed ceramic helmet was in the Phasmid's nest. It still has some reeds sticking out of it, and it smells of seawater, but it's otherwise wearable, if not exactly comfortable. Putting it on feels scary somehow. T-932 rifle scope. A common 30mm sniper scope attached to almost any bolt-action 4.46 caliber. It uses an older-style non-dotted range-finding reticle. Seaweed is still stuck on the lens, and it's suffered water damage from its time in the Phasmid's dowry. Yeah, I was wondering why we didn't, when we were talking to the man, we didn't say that, hey, where's the scope for your rifle? You killed the guy without a scope, blah blah blah. Evidence, Clashier's passport. I knew it. This well-traveled passport with visas stamped in it is issued by the Republic of Aranye. You found it in the Phasmid's nest on the island. You can open it for more details. The passport, a black-haired woman named Katarzyne Alasche. So that's why he didn't... Well, I knew that, too. Why didn't Harry knew that? That the name on the passport was not Clashier. Clashier's hidden documents. The lieutenant looks at it in your hands from the empty buoy. Look at the photo. It's Clashier, with short black hair and glasses. She looks boyish, younger somehow. What was this doing in the Phasmid's nest? Maybe our man, Mr. Dros, took it from Clashier's, or whatever her name was, hiding place, or... The Phasmid took it, and I sensed it do so. I saw something open up the buoy with spindly legs. Like a magpie? He looks around. What a coincidence that it would also have collected the other objects, which would be highly unusual. Rhetoric says, by now the lieutenant accepted your unusual methods. Figured so. I can see how the helmet could wash up on the island, and the scope. Maybe Mr. Dross lost it, but to seek out this would be very unusual behavior for an arthropod. It says, Katarzyne Alasaye. He opens his notes. She said it would be for Anouk Meyer Smith. Anouk Meyer Smith. Katarzyne Alasaye was supposed to be her real name, where Clashier comes from, goddammit. Katarzyne Alasaye was supposed to be her real name. She lied to us. Yes, somehow she managed to lie to us one more time. In a way, she's still lying to us right now. Lieutenant smiles. What's her real name, then? I don't know, but it's not Katarzyne Alasaye, or Clashier, or Anouk Meyer Smith. We didn't even scratch the surface with her, Detective. He looks east. Perhaps it's better that we didn't arrest her. Who knows what hell she'd be raising in my district by now. Alright. Back to you, sir.
What is it? What do you want from me? I can't go.
The old man looks around, confused. Composure says something is very wrong with him now. Sir, how could you not see the Phasmid?
See?
He stares at the reeds and falls silent. Mr. Dross? Kim says. The man does not respond. He keeps staring, black eyes glazed over and bulging from their sockets, his gap-toothed mouth shaking. Wave your hand in front of his eyes. A light shiver passes him, followed by nothing. His hands are trembling, and he breathes slowly. He's going into some kind of psychomotor immobility. Lieutenant inspects him gently. The good news is, this solves our transportation problem, doesn't it, Mr. Dross? The trembling mouth appears to sigh. Between this and the broken tire he's used for a boat, I think it's safe to leave him here while we go and get help. It will need to be medical first, I'm afraid. What has happened to this man? Old age and shock. He looks at him. Then you. I think it's the Phasmid. Yes, the arrest and the appearance of the Phasmid, the combined stress. He looks at you. But you think it's something more than that, don't you? Inland Empire says there's much more. Remember what it said when it spoke. Composure says quite a few things about that health check you done on him make sense now. He couldn't see it, Kim. It's just the reeds for him. That could be part of the shock, but you're right. Something is off here. Mr. Dross? He touches the man's shoulder. No response. Maybe this is how the Phasmid has stayed hidden all these years. Then how did we see it? He thinks. Oh, you mean whatever does it over time? Teenagers, kids, drunks? Sightings are brief, and hence not credible, but anyone who spends a long time with it... Yes, you forget it's there. The lieutenant inspects the man. Mr. Dross, have you ever seen a stick insect pretending to be the reeds? The old man stutters. The doctors have to look at this. I hope your station has better medical personnel than 57. This is a little advanced for a nurse. Before, when I evaluated his state, he seemed strangely animated. He nods. He was energetic and articulate. After all these years alone, with little hygiene or medication, I would expect worse. Perhaps this animation is induced by something in the Phasmid. It does not seem to be animated now, once it's left. He looks to the sea. Honestly, I'm ready to believe anything at this point. Maybe it is psychoactive. I mean, why not? It's 3 meters tall. He takes off his glasses and cleans them. When he puts them back on, he's staring at the sea. He's been here for a long time. Who knows how much of it in its company. He did seem distressed when it finally came to arresting him, like he didn't want to leave this place. And the insect, maybe. He looks at his notebook. I have absolutely forgotten to take notes. I hope I remember all this. He shakes his head in disbelief. This will be one hell of a report. Thank God we have the photo. Okay, so... done. Drama says, no one would believe you without it. We found some things in the Phasmid's nest, Mr. Dross. He stares into the reeds. Your words don't stir anything in him. Perhaps you should, show him the detached scope. Aye. He turns his eyes to it. I lost. You lost it, Mr. Dross? He turns his eyes to the reeds again, as he's done so many times. Beige and white stripes. He lost the scope, that it somehow made its way over here, with the help of a magpie Phasmid? The lieutenant observes lens sparkle. Observes the lens sparkle in your hand. The sight is a T9, Mr. Dross. Was it attached to the rifle when you made the shot? Silence. Not even a sigh. You've gotten all your will out of this poor being. Show him the RNA's passport. No reaction. His breathing is slow, and he appears very old all of a sudden. Around 80. Did you take this passport and other papers from a buoy on the coast? Kim asks. He blinks and continues to stare at the reeds. The spirit. He hears us? The spirit? No reply. He's gone again. Try something else? Kim asks. We've got him back for a moment. Show him the ceramic helmet. Nothing. Just dull staring. Not even rage left wherever he is. If Kuno kicked it into the sea, as he said he did, Kim asks. Kim says, the ebb would pull it back here. This makes sense. Mr. Joss could have picked it up. Or the Phasmid, even? If it did, this is incredible. Alright, well, I've asked everything. Try something else. I don't know. I'm gonna let you rest now, Mr. Dross. The plastic cape flaps around his face in a gust of wind. His back is slouched and his mouth open. Endurance says the strength has all gone out of him. Just frail old bones in a sack of tracksuit trousers and a windbreaker. Hang tight. Kim says we should think about getting him back to the mainland. To get help. He'll be safe here if we don't take too long. The return. Use the boat to return to mainland. Don't take too long, huh? Alright.
Yes?
Nothing. Alright. Let's head straight back. I don't know who can help us. I guess talk to... the Lien, and then go to the kinema to call the station. Alright, we have to run up there. Don't take too long. The skiff is swaying on the waves by the dock. Let's return to the mainland. Let's. We're done here, he says, adjusting his glasses as he looks out over the water. The skiff rocks gently under your weight as you get in. The ride back is uneventful and quiet. Perception says, but for the sound of conversation on the water, there's someone inland waiting for you. Esprit de Corps says, two men and a woman stand on the concrete square of a nameless village, looking at a small yellow boat as it draws closer. The sea is calm. Two men and a woman. Maybe that's the people that I actually came with that Ruby was talking about. You reach the jetty and climb out of the skiff. People. We got people. Harry, we're here because we're worried.
Look what the tide brought in.
Says the man without sunglasses. Suddenly, his expression changes and he tilts his head. Yep, my partner from the Whirling in Rags, no longer wearing his blonde wig.
Harry, you're bleeding all over the place. You're half dead.